Welcome to Take the Lead Radio with Dr. Diane Hamilton, where she interviews some of the most successful leaders, entrepreneurs, authors, speakers, and other individuals who will inspire you to take the lead in your career and personal life. And now, here is Dr. Diane Hamilton.
Welcome to Take the Lead Radio. This is Dr. Diane Hamilton, and I'm so glad you joined us today because we have Robbie Bach here. He was the chief Xbox officer at Microsoft. He's published several books, really interesting life. So I'm so excited to hear his story, and we will talk to Robbie right after this.
Are you interested in finding out more about how HR professionals or leadership consultants can become certified to give the groundbreaking new Curiosity Code Index assessment? The certification program will provide the ability to administer the assessment at reduced rates. Participants will learn how to interpret the results of the CCI, as well as how to deliver an innovation plan workshop designed to improve curiosity, engagement, innovation, and productivity. To find out more, go to curiositycode.com.
I am here with Robbie Bach, who is best known for founding and leading the team that created the Xbox. Today, he's entertaining at events as a storyteller and catalyzing voice who writes books and speaks to audiences on leadership, creativity, strategy, and civic issues. He's written several books, and I'm very excited to have him here because he also has a yellow lab named Roscoe, and I have a new baby lab, so I'm very excited to hear about Roscoe. But it's so nice to have you here, Robbie.
Thanks, Dad. Thanks for having me. And I will just tell you that Roscoe is comfortably sleeping on his mat right next to me as we talk.
Oh, well, your lab behaves a lot better than mine. Mine's only just turned one, and she's still not great for radio shows yet.
Roscoe understands his role. He's here as a quiet advisor.
But you know, I got a white one. I had a yellow one in the past, and I'm loving the white color. She's so cute, but boy, she's a puppy. But I want to hear more about you because I know a lot of people are familiar with your work, but for those who may not know your backstory, would you mind sharing it?
Yeah, sure. I mean, I suppose it depends on how far you want to go back, but I went to college at the University of North Carolina, played tennis there, went to business school at Stanford, and then came to Microsoft in 1988. And the first part of my career was spent overseas, actually, and then working on Microsoft Office and building that business. And then I went to spend 10 years working in the consumer part of the business, which started with the founding and building of the Xbox business, which was just an amazing once in a lifetime type experience. In 2010, I left Microsoft and with the intention of pursuing other interests, and that sort of goes into a couple of different categories. The first is I do a lot of nonprofit board work. I'm very involved in the Boys and Girls Club movement. I'm involved in an organization called the Bipartisan Policy Center, and I served on the board of the U.S. Olympic and Paralympic Committee for 10 years. I am a small business owner, so we own a small gluten-free pasta company called Zucchini's. And I do a lot of guest lecturing and writing and have discovered a deep passion for writing, and that's what led to my first book, Xbox Revisited, and now my current novel, so my first fiction effort that just released called The Wilkes Insurrection.
Well, that's quite an interesting background. And as you were going back, it made me go back a little bit because I remember working as a VAR for IBM in 1985.
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah, it's been a while selling System 36s, you know? Think about that, how long ago
it
was.
I did a, just as a small aside, I did a summer internship with IBM in their office products division. So this is like typewriters.
Right.
In 1982. So I know that well. My brother was an IBM salesman for 35 years. So our backgrounds have clearly crossed.
It's amazing. I was thinking I had my first kind of computerized typewriter would remember about two lines behind you, and I would type faster than it did, and I'd get up and I'd walk away and still be like typing what I typed a second ago, and I'd come back, and that was such high tech. So it had to be really cool to get that job working at Microsoft. I mean, in the day, what was that like?
Well, you know, it's super interesting. I had my choices coming out of business school were to go work with in sales organizations, and because I'd interviewed for a lot of sales jobs, or to come work at Microsoft. Microsoft was far and away the most technical-oriented company I was talking with, and I don't have a deep technical background, at least not academically. And I decided to go to Microsoft because it was the hardest, most challenging day of interviews I've ever done, to this day.
Oh, I imagine.
7 hours straight of interviews, including lunch and dinner. So I lost like 3 pounds during the day because I never got a chance to eat. and I walked away from it, and I said, I got to go to work at a place that's that intellectually challenging and interesting and careful about who they hire. And, you know, fell in love with the company as a result, and, you know, that's the bulk of my professional career was spent there.
I didn't realize they put you through the worst. I think I had was AstraZeneca was pretty intense. I worked there for 20 years, and they put you through quite a bit. It was all in one day like that, though. That's pretty intense. So
it is. It's super intense, but you know, you get a real sense for the culture of the place.
To me, in
the long scheme of things in my life, I've learned more about culture than anything else, and I've just concluded that's, you know, one of the primary things you have to think about when you're thinking about organizations.
Well, so did you deal directly with Gates when you were creating all these things? I mean, where was he in this?
Oh, yeah. Bill Gates and Steve Ballmer were deeply involved, obviously, in the office work because that was right at the center of the company. And then also with Xbox. I mean, I worked for Steve for 7 or 8 years, this last 7 or 8 years of my career. And I met with Bill probably every 6 weeks or so during that time frame, talking about various technical issues and things we would do. And those would always end up being two people meeting with Bill, me and somebody on the team who really understood the technology, because Bill had this amazing capacity to go very deep in very specific areas. So if you want to talk about silicon core technology,
yeah,
I had to bring our number one silicon guy to talk with him because I would be done in 5 minutes. And Bill could go step for step, toe for toe with a guy whose entire life was based on this. And they were really great conversations, and he learned a bunch, and we took a bunch of good action items away, and those were super, super interactions.
Well, whose idea was Xbox? I mean, that's got to be fun to work on.
Yeah, I get this question every once in a while. People say, so who's the father or mother of Xbox? And the truth is, there isn't one person. Mm-hmm. So there were sort of two things going on at the beginning. One, there were some groups inside Microsoft who, independent of their day jobs, were doing some exploration work and saying, hey, Microsoft should get into this console business. And there was a group called the DirectX group who did the gaming technology for Windows, and another group of people who had come from the gaming industry and joined Microsoft in a different context. So those two groups are in the background sort of working on various things. And then we had an executive staff retreat, and we had this process of exploring new topics. And one of the topics that somebody raised was, should Microsoft compete with Sony in the living room? And Sony came out with this product called PlayStation 2, and they were calling it a personal computer in the living room. So you can imagine the attention that statement got inside Microsoft. And so at this executive staff retreat, 4 or 5 of us got together with Bill. Literally, it's just such a weird meeting. We're literally sitting in a bedroom and at a hotel and talked about it. And from that, he went and met with the groups that had been doing this sort of garage shop work, and came back with a technical proposal, and then a team that worked for me said, okay, let's see if we can make this a business. And by the end of that year, this was in 1999, by the end of that year, Bill and Steve approved the project that became known as Xbox.
And it's been such a huge success. I mean, it's just fun to see what this console market has done. I mean, Pong was the thing when I was a kid.
Right, yeah, exactly.
And you look at what you can do now. I teach at a university here. I teach for several universities, but one of them is a tech school, and I remember telling me, was it Quest, the virtual reality headset thing? I have one. All these things are so cool that it must be just so fun to get on the ground floor. What made you leave there?
Well, you know, my philosophy on, you know, I get asked the question, so when should I change jobs, when should I leave? I get asked that question all the time.
Right.
And I tell people there's sort of 3 criteria for me. One, are you really passionate about what you're doing? You know, we spend so much time, quote-unquote, at work, why would you do it if you weren't passionate about it? To me, you have to really enjoy the subject matter and love the day-to-day of what you're doing. And then the second thing I say is, do you love the people you're working with? And, you know, you don't have to love them every day, but yeah. in the grand course of your job, uh-huh. you have to say, wow, I really appreciate these people. It's good to interact. I look forward to meetings, all those kinds of things. And then the third thing is you have to say, am I learning something new? You know, I'm a believer that life is about learning, and it's a lifelong process. And so when I got to 2008, 2009, I was managing Xbox plus a portfolio of other businesses, and I wasn't passionate about it being a portfolio manager. Hmm. And I didn't feel like I was learning as much as I wanted. And I had other things outside of my job at Microsoft that I was more passionate about. And so you get to that place, and, you know, and then it's really right at the end. Microsoft, you know, sort of senior leadership culture got a little sideways. And so all of that together just said, hey, this is time. And I feel really fortunate. I tell people I loved every month I was at Microsoft. And I can say that honestly. Not every day, but every month I was at Microsoft, I loved. And I can also say that since the day I left, I've not missed it. And I think that's a great fortune to be able to have a really great adventure like that, and then to be able to leave and say, you know, you left, you know, pretty close to the right time.
Yeah, I think that's really important. I love the learning thing, of course, since my books sure. are about curiosity, and I work with corporations to build their curiosity levels. And I'm in your first book, Xbox Revisited, A Game Plan for Corporate and Civic Renewal. What were you hoping to accomplish with that? Was this to share an experience of what you went through with Xbox and how it could be extrapolated? Can you give me a little background on that? I'm curious.
Yeah, so Xbox, it's not a tell-all memoir book. Mm-hmm. But what it is it uses the Xbox experience to make a very important point about strategy.
Okay.
The Xbox business was deeply in trouble in the beginning. The first 2 years were really bad. The first version of that product, the original Xbox, lost, I don't know, depending on how you do the math, somewhere between $5 and $7 billion.
Wow.
So the business strategically was not in a good place, and it's because the way we got started, we just said run fast, run hard, produce a product, and we didn't really step back and take a strategic approach to it. So that book was about really communicating to people, look, when you have a complex, difficult problem, you have to come up with a deeply simple but very specific strategy for addressing it. And so we had this process we did on Xbox, which I now call the 3P framework. And it basically says in three pages, tell me your purpose, the principles you're going to pursue to achieve that purpose, and the priorities you're going to do to get it done. You know, purpose, principles, and priorities, three pages, nothing long, nothing complicated, but deeply important to get clear on those things. And so in that book, I talk about the Xbox experience and how we use the 3P framework, but I also then apply it to what's going on in our country, maybe the deepest and most complicated problem of all. And, you know, leave aside whether I did that successfully or not, the framework itself I have used in all the consulting work I do, all the nonprofit organizations I work with, and it does work. Yeah. And, you know, forcing people to step away from the keyboard and, you know, people look at complex problems and say, okay, I got to come up with a complex solution. And I think that's just bass-ackward, to use the expression. and I think you really have to say, okay, how do we simplify this to a place where we can make progress? And then you take one step in front of another, and you pound your way through the complexity to the other side.
Well, just because I have so many people ask me for examples of companies that have utilized curiosity to be successful. I was speaking yesterday at an entrepreneur organization meeting, and they're always wanting to hear success stories of what kind of experience did you have in terms of the corporate culture, either at Microsoft or anywhere else, where they encouraged or maybe didn't encourage curiosity enough?
Microsoft was a place that I would say loved curiosity. Mm-hmm. And it loved people who were explorers. Mm-hmm. So I have this small leadership framework in my head where I think people are either explorers, pioneers, or settlers. all of which are great and all of which are really important.
Uh-huh.
And ironically, I'm more of a settler. I'm a person who likes to scale things that exist. That's what mm-hmm. I do well.
Mm-hmm.
But Microsoft was filled with people who were explorers and pioneers. That was just the,
what if you failed? How was the reaction? Was it fail forward?
No, that was okay.
Mm-hmm.
Failure happened all the time. Look, mm-hmm. the number of times Bill said to me, well, that was dumb. no, I got told that the official Bill Gates expression was, that's the stupidest thing I've ever heard. But, I got told that a lot. You know, Xbox, uh-huh. how many CEOs run a business and loses $5 to $7 billion and get a chance to do the next version?
Yeah, that's a very good point. But, you know, did he say it in a way that made you not want to give him any future ideas? Or was it just kind of like, that's just what he says?
No, that's it. Everybody sort of knew that was, you know, response mm-hmm. number four.
Yeah.
And he never said it when he didn't mean it, in the mm-hmm. sense that it wasn't a throwaway line. He
uh-huh.
he really said, okay, you made a mistake.
Uh-huh.
And here's why. And, you know, the challenge to being at Microsoft, the hard part about being at Microsoft was, when somebody said that, you had to be able to respond. And there's two ways you respond. You either say, yeah, you're right, and we're fixing it. That's mm-hmm. one response.
Right.
Or two, you say, no, you're wrong, and here's why.
Mm-hmm.
And there's no in between.
Right.
And as long as you understood that, Microsoft was an amazing place. And if you were a curious mind, God, Microsoft explored so many different areas. I mean, everybody talks about all the successes and Office and Windows and Exchange and Xbox and Azure and all those things. The list of things that failed is like 100 miles long.
Yeah. Well,
and it was okay.
Yeah. I mean, it's just like being a VC. They invest in so many companies, but just to get the one that makes all the money, right? And it's interesting to look at your path, because, you know, obviously you did these amazing things and you become an author, and then you switched over to writing novels. The Wilkes Insurrection, is that your latest book?
It is. And here's the thing I would say about that. To your point about curiosity,
mm-hmm.
The Wilkes Insurrection is for me, at a personal level, an effort in curiosity. Right? I learned with Xbox Revisited, that first book, that I like to write. But I didn't want to write a second nonfiction book. I didn't want to write a second business book.
Mm-hmm.
I wanted to explore my creative side. You know, I worked on Xbox for 10 years, and you learn a lot about creativity, and you start to think in a different way. And so I wanted to say, hey, can I do this? Can I create a fiction world? Can I write characters? Can I write dialogue? Can I do a plot? Can I think about scene description? And can I do pacing in a thriller? You know, The Wilkes Insurrection is a techno thriller.
Mm.
And if you're doing that kind of writing, pacing is everything. And so the personal challenges, and to your point, the curiosity of reaching out and doing new things was amazing for me. And, you know, the reviews will indicate the result is really great, and I'm super proud of it. But I'm also really proud and just have learned a great deal and love that experience. And so it's just been good for me as a person, and I think the outcome is a great book.
You know, it reminds me a little bit of Robin Cook writing all the, you know, medical based books, which I loved his books. And
sure.
So you're kind of doing the same thing with the techno thriller from being in the tech industry. And I think those are sometimes the best books because you have that background. So can you give me the plot a little bit?
Sure. Yeah, sure. So the basics of the Wilkes Insurrection are, there is an anarchist who believes it's his mission to take down the U.S. government. And his way of doing that is by sowing chaos and confusion across the country. And it starts with him planting a bomb on a plane that crash lands at a U.S. Air Force base, Offutt Air Force Base. And my lead character is a woman named Major Tamika Smith. She is the combat search and rescue leader at Offutt Air Force Base, and she rescues people from that plane. And she then, over time, becomes enmeshed in this anarchist's attempts to take down the government. And, you know, there's clear cyber activity in this thriller. There's a technical, actually an augmented virtual reality company that plays a role in the subplot of the story. And the story then becomes about his march to destroy the government, and Tanika and a couple other of the main characters work to try to stop him. And, you know, I wrote most of this in 2016 and 2017. The bones of the plot was all finished at that point. And, you know, I tried to write things that I thought were, you know, a little bit out there. And then I watched as, you know, many of the things I wrote about happened in various ways, shapes, and forms. And so the book, you know, the subtitle of the book is a contemporary novel. It's about what's going on right now in our country. Not a political left or right statement, but just a thriller enmeshed in the environment we live in.
Well, I think Coma was Robin Cook's, right? And he made a movie out of that. Are you going to make a movie out of this?
Well, you know, it's one of those things when you get done, you sort of say, you know, I love the book. And I think it has strengths that could play to, you know, a movie or to, you know, one of these 10-part miniseries type things that are now really popular.
Right.
So I'll probably explore that a little bit. You know how that process works. It's deeply complicated. And you can sell a script for a little bit of money and then never see anything happen. Or you can, you know, really try to bring the story to life. And so we'll see how that goes. It wasn't the place I started. But when you get characters like Major Tanika Smith is a real character. She is, she's a biracial woman. She's been in she served her country. She gets involved in politics in this story. She's very rich and has deep dimension. And so when you're able to get a character like that, you want to bring it into life as many ways as you can.
You might want to listen to one of my shows. Sheila Barry Driscoll was on, and she takes a lot of VC-type opportunities on, mostly in the entertainment industry, and she gives a lot of great insight on that. And
I will definitely look that up.
Yeah, she's great. She used to run the Billionaire Society. I can't remember exactly the name of it, but she's wonderful. But she, as you were telling me this, you know, I know you do a lot to talk to groups, and you discuss civic leadership and where we are as a country. What got you so interested in that?
Well, that goes back a long way. I have been a lover of history and a lover of civics. I don't know, it's sort of genetic almost. I can go back to eighth and ninth grade to the times when I want to talk about it. My freshman year in college, I was in this leadership program. They said, write what you want to be when you grow up, which I think is kind of a weird exercise. But anyway, I did it. And I said, I want to be a U.S. senator. That was my original ambition. And, of course, your life and your career develops in different ways. And so I developed away from that, ended up in the technology world, which I'm grateful for because that was an amazing experience. But I never really lost the interest in civics. And so since I've left Microsoft, I've become more involved in that. I'm the chair of the board in an organization called the Bipartisan Policy Center, which is a policy group in Washington, D.C. that actually works with senators and congressmen and women from both sides of the aisle to try to drive productive change. Like this recent infrastructure bill that finally got passed, the BPC played an important role in helping shape that and get it done. So that kind of work to me is fascinating, and it's sort of consistent with my theme of working on hard problems and trying to help us make progress.
Well, you do so many interesting things. What's next for you other than continuing to love peanut M&Ms? I was looking at some of your I love them as well.
But there were a lot of peanut M&Ms consumed in the course of writing the Wilkes Insurrection, I can promise you that. You know, I will you talk about life and curiosity and how we develop a lot in what you do. So I share that in a few weeks I turn 60, and so, you know, this is one of those transition points in your life. I've just completed my second book. I'm turning 60. I just became a grandfather.
Oh,
and so I'm literally in the process of saying, okay, where do I want to go next? I have a bunch of things that I'm still committed to, which I really love, and I'll continue doing those. But should I write a second book? There's clearly opportunities for a sequel to The Wilkes Insurrection, just given the strength of the characters and the storyline. Do I want to do that? Do I want to do something else? You know, so I'm as I said at the beginning, I'm a strong believer in lifelong learning, and I'm curious about lots of different topics. So we'll see where that takes me.
Well, you know, it is interesting. A lot of people are trying to figure out what they want to do now with COVID. Everybody's had kind of a chance to reflect on whether they love what they're doing or not. And what do you think? Will we see a hybrid workplace? Do you think we'll ever go back to working all the time in the office? Or do you think we're going to be Zoom fatigued for the rest of our lives? Or where is it going to go from here, do you think?
Well, I'm a believer in the in-between space. Mm-hmm. I think a lot of it depends on your job function. Look, if you're a hardware engineer, as an example, so if you're building planes or you're building computers or you're doing hardware technology for consumer devices or whatever, you're going to be more back in the office because it's just too hard to do that out of your house.
Mm-hmm.
There are other people who are consultants and service providers and those kinds of things, and they'll be, you know, more out of an office than not. I think most organizations are going to end up in this world where they are hybrid. They have requirements for people to be in the office a certain amount of the time. They have flexibility about when they can be out of the office, and they're going to feel free to say, hey, sorry, on that Thursday you have to be here because we're having a group meeting. We need everybody together. The thing that you lose in the work from home initiative is you lose the culture formation that happens when people are together.
Mm-hmm.
And it's really hard to imagine a world in which we weren't giving people opportunities to do that. And most of the workers I talk to, young and older like me, miss that.
Yeah.
And so finding the right balance is going to be super important. I think what happens when you go through these abrupt periods of change, you take the pandemic, you take what's going on in the country, there's a lot of grinding and change going on, and it's easy to predict radical outcomes. And typically what happens is we come back to center, and the center we come back to is different than where we were before, but it's not all the way out to the extremes.
Yeah, it's going to be interesting to see how this all goes. And you're dealing with this, obviously, with, is it Manini's, your gluten-free pasta and baking company? Tough time to be in that, I bet.
Well, you know, it's a 30-person company. And, mm-hmm. you know, we sell nationally, though. We're in Whole Foods and a number of other stores like mm-hmm. that. And we make fresh gluten-free pasta, ravioli, pizza dough balls, pizza crusts, etc. And so as business owners, we had to go through the question, okay, do we want a PPP loan?
Mm-hmm.
And my business partner and I determined we didn't want to take that because we felt like we could fund the company without it. We didn't think it was fair for us to take that. We had to have the decision about what do we do about employee work rules, because you got to be in the facility to make pasta.
Right.
And so we did a lot of work on social distancing. We did a lot of training on mask wearing. And, you know, because we're a food company, people had a pretty good sense of sanitation, obviously, anyway.
Right, right.
So the place was always clean. But, you know, we had to really work to enforce that. And we told our employees, if you're feeling sick, don't come to work. We will still pay you.
Yeah,
but
wow.
we just don't want you in the workplace. And call us, tell us, get a test, and then come back. And you know, and then you get all the way through that, and then you have to have the decision, okay, what do we do about vaccination? And we ultimately made the decision that because it was a group safety and health issue, that we required everybody in the company to be vaccinated.
Wow.
And we lost one employee.
Oh.
But the rest of the people, you know, and we obviously gave people time off to go get vaccinated. We actually did it as a group activity.
Hmm.
And, you know, I think we made the right calls in all of that, but you can just tell that, you know, these are hard, difficult times. If you're a business leader or running a small business or running a retail store or a restaurant, you think about the decisions you have to make every day, and it is not easy. I'm super empathetic with people who are struggling with that, because I think it has created a lot of emotional and psychic stress for people. There's no question about that.
Yeah, it's a tough time. Everybody's that I know, you know, trying to adjust to being home or working through virtual situations. I know a lot of people have got new Labradors because.
Yeah, the dog adoption business has been pretty good.
It has been. It has been. And mine's named Luna. She'll have to meet Roscoe sometime. But it is so nice of you to share your success and your story and your books and everything on the show. And I think a lot of people are going to want to know how they could find you, read your books, find out more about you. Is there something you'd like to share so people can do that?
Yeah, the easiest way, there's two places to go to find out information about me. One is www.wilksinsurrection, so the title of the book, .com, and that has all the information on the book. There's a video trailer, so you can get a sense for what the story is about, and obviously places for you to order. And then if you really want to get to know me better and the broader work I do, my website is creatively www.robbiebach.com. That has information about my speaking. My blog posts are all there. And obviously you can follow me on LinkedIn, Facebook, or Instagram. I do most of my blog work on LinkedIn.
Yeah, I've seen a lot of your stuff, and this is really great. And I was so looking forward to this. Thank you so much, Robbie. I really enjoyed our conversation.
Appreciate you having me on, Diane. Take care.
You're welcome. And we'll be back right after this message. Curiosity is a critical and direct link to improving motivation and communication-based issues that challenge organizations. By improving workers' curiosity, you can enhance employee engagement, emotional intelligence, innovation, productivity, and many other byproducts that come with that intrinsic but underutilized attribute. To find out more about how to improve curiosity, please go to curiositycode.com. This show is going to be a little bit different today, and I'm kind of excited about it because I'm going to be talking about curiosity. And I talk on a lot of other people's shows about what I work on, but I want to talk to you about the value of building curiosity within your organization. So I guess I'm my guest today. So hi, I'm Dr. Diane Hamilton. And in addition to hosting this show, I am also the creator of the Curiosity Code Index, and I wrote the book, Cracking the Curiosity Code. And I give a lot of presentations where I talk about the importance of improving curiosity and getting out of status quo thinking. And it sometimes helps if I share a story that I think you might find fascinating. A lot of organizations are held back by a culture that doesn't really embrace curiosity. They just go along with the way things have always been. And so I like to talk about an experiment that I share on stage, about a hidden camera experiment where they looked at how quickly people go along with a group. This woman, she went into a doctor's office thinking she's getting an eye exam, but not known to her, everybody in the waiting room, they weren't patients, they were actors. And every so often, an experiment was going on where they would have a bell ring, and every time that bell would ring, all the actors around her, which she thought were patients, would stand up and sit down with no explanation. So after just three times hearing about that, from hearing the bell ring, I should say, and without knowing why she was doing it, the woman stood up and sat down conforming with the group. And so they thought, well, this is interesting. She's going along with what everybody else is doing. Let's see what happens if we take everybody out of the room. So once, you know, they call everybody back as if they were patients one at a time, and eventually she's alone in the room. And the bell rings, and what'd she do? Well, she stood up and sat down, and she doesn't know why she's doing it. She's just going along with what everybody else had done, right? So they thought, well, this is fascinating. Let's just add some people to the room who are patients, and see how she responds to the bell ringing and see how they respond. And so the bell goes off, and she stands up and sits down, and the gentleman next to her looks at her and says, why did you do that? She said, well, everybody else was doing it. I thought I was supposed to. And so the next time the bell rings, what do you think he does? Well, he gets up and sits down with her. And so slowly but surely, what became, you know, just was a random rule for one woman is now the social rule for everybody in the waiting room. And we call that behavior, it's an internalized behavior that we call social learning. So we see what other people do and we think, wow, that's kind of what I want to do because everybody else is doing it. And we kind of reward ourselves and because we don't want to be excluded. And it's just the part of how conformity can be comfortable, but going along with it just sometimes is, you get bad habits, you stunt growth, you get the status quo thinking, and that could be the downfall of organizations. So when we do things just because they've always been done a certain way, we don't really progress and we don't look for other ways to find solutions. So I want to go beyond that. I want to know why we're doing things. Why is it important? And what are we trying to accomplish? So that's what I talk to companies about, because I think they need to look at like how and where are they modeling and fostering curiosity, and what action plans do they have in place to avoid status quo thinking, and do they really have all the answers? And how can they take what they learn from different events and utilize that to make some changes? And it's really important because curiosity has been, you know, the foundation behind the Model T to self-driving cars. And we know that leaders believe they encourage curiosity and exploration. But I've had Francesca Gino on the show, who's done a lot of real great research in this area. And we know that most of the employees don't feel rewarded for it if they explore their curiosity. So if we want organizations to generate innovative ideas, we have to help them through leaders developing that desire to explore, right? So my job is to be curious. I ask questions and get information for a living. And I do that through the show and teaching and speaking and everything I do. But I think it's something I want to share with other people because it's just such a huge part of what makes companies successful. I look at curiosity as the spark that ignites the process that everybody's trying to achieve. Think of it as baking a cake, okay? If your goal is to bake a cake, you've got all these ingredients. You have eggs and milk and flour, whatever it is it takes to bake the cake, and you mix it together and you put it in the pan and you put it in the oven, what happens? Well, if you didn't turn on the oven, you get goo, right? Nothing happens. And so that's a huge problem that organizations are trying to get, instead of cake, they're trying to get productivity, right? We're trying to make money. They know the ingredients. They know they want motivation and drive and engagement, creativity, communication, all the soft skills, all that stuff. So they're mixing those ingredients, and what they're not doing is turning on the oven. And the oven, the spark, is curiosity. So if you don't turn on the oven, no one gets cake. So that's what I'm trying to talk to companies about. And, you know, we know that kids are naturally curious. I love a picture from the San Francisco Museum of Art from Life magazine in 1963. They have these two little girls. They're just adorable, looking through this like grate on the ground, on the wall, that they can see like behind the air conditioning vent kind of thing. And they're supposed to be looking at all the artwork on the walls, of course, because it's the San Francisco Museum of Art. But what do kids do? They want to see what's behind the vent, right? And we're all that way. Three-year-olds ask their parents about 100 questions a day. But at that age, you're just curious. You want to find out how everything works, right? And there's some time that we just eventually lose some of that. And think about it. When did you stop wanting to look behind the vent? And did somebody actually like say, stop that, get up, you're getting dirty, don't look behind there? I mean, we get that. That's what our parents do. You know, you have to behave. But we've seen a big decline in curiosity and creativity. There's some great TED Talks about the creativity aspect, which ties in very similarly to what curiosity, what we see. And it peaks around age 5, and then it tanks as soon as you go through school, and about the age of 18 through 31 even, we're seeing very low levels. Sir Ken Robinson has a great talk about how we educate people out of our creativity and out of our competencies. George Land also has a great talk about his work with NASA. He looked at kids, he followed them at age 5, found that 98% of children were creative geniuses. And then by the time they were 31, only 2% were. And it was a huge difference. And a lot of it, George Land says, that we have convergent and divergent thinking. And he talks about it in terms of, we put on the gas and try to come up with all these great ideas, but at the same time, we over-criticize them and we put on the brake. So anybody who drives a car knows you put the brake on at the same time you put on the gas, you don't go very far. And that's kind of what's happening to our curiosity and our creativity. And I thought, well, this is really interesting because I think curiosity can translate into serious business results, and CEOs get that. But a lot of them are not investing in the culture of curiosity, but some of them are really doing some amazing things. So I want to talk about why, what the cost is of lost curiosity. And what it is, there's so many aspects of what costs companies. We know that they're losing $16.8 billion due to emotional intelligence if you ask the consortium for EI, or if you look at Gallup's numbers, they're losing $500 billion a year lost due to poor engagement. I've seen everything from communication. Holmes has it at $37 billion. I've seen much higher. Just depends where you look. But we're talking tens to hundreds of billions for each of these issues: emotional intelligence, communication, engagement. It's a huge problem out there. And companies know that they're losing money, but they don't recognize the value sometimes of curiosity. And when we talk about curiosity, there's a big innovation factor, because we want to to be more innovative, but we're worried about job loss. We're worried about jobs being automated. But we know that if we're not innovative, the majority of the Fortune 500 companies from 1995 are gone, and they don't. No one wants to be Kodak. Nobody wants to be Blockbuster. We know that, you know, Netflix just ate Blockbuster's lunch, and a lot of it. The reason those companies are not here is because they looked at things from the status quo way that they've always done things. They didn't want to cannibalize their product or whatever, you know, that they had the success they had. And if you do that, the world keeps moving and you get stuck, and then that's a huge problem. So it was interesting to me to study curiosity. There's a lot of research on curiosity, but there's not the great statistics I'd like to see. There's a State of Curiosity report that Merck did in 2018, and it showed that curiosity was higher in larger companies than smaller ones. It was, I think, 37% versus 20%. And then millennials were more curious than Gen Z and boomers, and the U.S. had a higher level of curiosity compared to China, but maybe they weren't as high as Germany. But it's, you know, that's just one report. I'd like to see a lot more research done. I think that it's fun to look at what experts have shared regarding the value of curiosity. And I mentioned that Francesca Gino did a great job with a HBR article she wrote. And I loved having her on the show. I hope you check out that show because it's amazing. Because in that report, she talked about leaders recognize curiosity is important and they think that they're encouraging it. But we found that most of the employees don't believe that. Only 24% feel like they're curious about their jobs, and 70% said they face barriers to staying curious and asking questions. And so she did some really great research. If you get a chance, I would recommend listening to that show and also checking out that HBR article. I've had Daniel Goleman on the show. He was incredible. We talked about how emotional intelligence ties in. And he was cute because he said he can see why I developed a measure of curiosity because I'm very curious. He was talking about an article in HBR as well by Claudio Fernanda, or I think it's A-R-A-O-Z, saying that curiosity is one of the most important competencies in the future. So that's a huge, plug for curiosity coming from Daniel Goleman. And he was talking about younger generations have questioned organizational missions more than older generations. And we got into a great discussion about that. So I hope you take some time to listen to that show. Another great episode on the show was with Amy Edmondson, who has an incredible TED Talk. And she gets into curiosity and how it ties into collaboration. She does a TED Talk about teams and teaming, and she gets into how the Chilean miner disaster was able to be resolved because of a lot of it was because of curiosity. She says, you know, you got to look at what are you trying to get done, your goal, what's in your way, you know, your concerns, your worries, your barriers, stuff like that. And what resources, talent, skills, and experience do you bring? And then she talks about how they did all that to get those Chilean miners out from under that rock. So definitely worth watching her TED Talk. All of them have TED Talks that are amazing. A really great guest as well on the show was Doug Conant, who is the guy who turned around Campbell's Soup. And he did that by asking questions. He asked employees what motivated them. And then he looked at how to build engagement by writing, he says, 10 to 20 personal notes 6 days a week. He counted at 30,000 plus, which is huge. Because when he took over, I think it was in 2002, they had like 12% engagement. And by 2009, they were up to 68%. So he did some amazing things by asking questions, writing comments, giving input. All that stuff comes out of curiosity. And another great guest of the show was Xander Lurie, who's the CEO of SurveyMonkey, and they're so much into curiosity, they got permission to change their street address to One Curiosity Way. I love that. But I was asking him some of the things that they do because they have a culture of curiosity there, and they ask, you know, how can we make our products more productive for our customers? How can we create an environment where people do their best work? He says they do skip-level meetings so that they can find out what works and what doesn't. So those are just some examples of people who are on the show. And I think that there's other examples that I think are really fascinating. Some companies, Monopoly, Ben & Jerry's, Van Moof Bicycles, some of those, I've looked at some of them to see how they used curiosity to just go a step further. Monopoly did some research because, you know, they always come out with the dog's version or cat's version, and they didn't want to come out with just another version. So they decided to come out with some research to find out what people did with Monopoly and what they can learn about it. And they found out that a lot of people cheat, and over half the people cheat when they play Monopoly. So they came out with the Cheaters Edition. And that was their second biggest release since the initial release of Monopoly. So it was really a cool thing. Ben and Jerry's has got some really interesting information. What they do in terms of not getting into status quo thinking, they don't just keep flavors around forever. They do research to find out what's working. They ask questions. What's a good flavor? What's no longer a good flavor? And instead of freaking out that their flavors are no longer successful, they celebrate them and give them a burial. And I love that. They even have a headstone and whatever on their website, and where they show this flavor was, you know, alive from this year to this year, and they celebrate their success and then they move on. A story I think is really interesting is Van Moof. They make these bikes, and they would send them in packages in the mail or through UPS or whatever they would send. And a lot of them were ending up broken, and they kept trying to fix these bikes, this issue with the packaging. And they didn't want to spend a lot more money because if, you know, you make the package twice the size, you get a lot more expenses. And they're trying to figure out how to do this to make their bikes not break and yet not go over on the spending. And what they looked at was the type of box they were using. They noticed it was very similar to a flat screen television box. And they looked into how many flat screens broke, and they really weren't breaking. And the only real difference was the flat screens had a picture of a flat screen on the box. So they thought, well, let's draw a picture of a flat screen, a little bit of extra ink, and see what happens. And it was a dramatic difference in the amount of damaged bicycles. So, you know, just thinking outside the box. Sometimes it's just asking questions, and Disney did a lot of that. They did some great questioning to find out what was happening with their turnover. The laundry division of Disney, as glamorous as it sounds, is not. And they were losing a lot of people that didn't really love working there. And they couldn't figure out why. So they just put out a questionnaire to their employees and said, you know, how can we make your job better? And really didn't expect to get things back that they could do anything about. But they did. They actually got back great things. And they got back things like put an air vent over my workspace or make my table adjustable so for, you know, when I'm folding things, it works for my height. And those are things like, yeah, we can fix that. And they did. So going to the horse's mouth, the employee, and say, hey, how can we make this better, was huge for them. Sometimes it's not just the employee. Sometimes it's leaders. I in the book, Cracking the Curiosity Code, I gave a story about Great Ormond Street Hospital in London. They were having a lot of patients that were dying when they were being transferred from one unit to the other. And some physicians were watching a Formula One race car event one night and were really impressed by how quickly that pit crew, the Formula One crew, would take the car apart, put it back together in 7 seconds. And they're looking at this going, wow, look at, they did that with no problems, and we can't transfer people from here to here. So they thought, well, why don't we have these guys come in, this Ferrari team, and they can show us, you know, any kind of improvements that we could make. And they really did get some great ideas, which reduced their errors by more than 50%. So, you know, we think inside of our cubicle, we think inside of our silos, but sometimes we need to think outside of even our industry, because that can be really important. And some of the greatest ideas are from that. I gave you some examples, but, you know, we know we came up with Velcro from a Swiss engineer hunting with his dog. He came back with burrs in his fur. And he's like, well, what are these things? And why are they sticking? And what he did was he stuck it, you know, under the light to look at it. And he saw it kind of had a hook and eye, you know, the way it hooked together. And they thought, why don't we try this? And they made, I think in 1998, they made something like $93 million in Velcro, and it was sold in 40 countries. I mean, it just did amazingly well. But you have to build a culture of learning. And to do that, I think it's really important to look at some companies that do a great job of it. And I know a top company I work with that does that is Novartis. Novartis does a great job because they have curiosity is part of their core cultural value. They actually encourage employees to spend 100 hours a year on employer-paid education to broaden their interests. And they do everything from paying for them to watch videos to having them perform in mini TED events, having employees be the actual speakers, things like that. It's really cool how much they do this. They actually have the whole month of September as their Curiosity Month. I'm one of the speakers for them, so I know how much time and effort they put into this. And it's just, if you look at how much everybody talks about how they liked working at the company, 90% of the employees surveyed approved of the CEO. Think of how often you see that. So that's a huge thing. And I know they're doing some ongoing research with Curiosity with me. And I'm very excited for that. They have one of their employees is writing her doctoral dissertation, and we're looking at, you know, the Curiosity, how it compares to if you intervene and give them some information about things that are holding them back. And so I'm really anxious to share that information when it comes out, because I did a lot of a lot of research for a lot of my talks and for my book, Cracking the Curiosity Code. And I looked at so much that's out there. I mean, we know that there's some great TED Talks from Daniel Pink. He wrote Drive, what a great book. Simon Sinek's Finding Your Why and all the stuff that he's talking about. Carol Dweck's book, Mindset. All those are huge. And I really think, you know, I started to look at what this is, this curiosity thing. Because it's actually, the Max Planck Institute coined the term the curiosity gene. Because it's in people, it's in animals. And, you know, it creates dopamine. It makes us feel good. And if you don't have curiosity, if you're a bird and you're just flying around a bush and you run out of berries, you're going to die if you don't have curiosity to go look at another bush. So I wanted to know, as I was researching for the book, I wanted to write about curiosity, but I'm like, okay, well, where's the assessment that tells you what stops it? And then I'm like, wait a minute, there isn't one. And that surprised me, because the assessments all told you if you were curious or not. And that's all well and good, because you do want to know if somebody's highly curious or not. And, you know, big five factors will tell you if you're open to experience and things like that. But I want to know what stops it. And so nobody had studied that. So I did. I wanted to know what holds us back. And I found out what it is fate. And fate stands for fear, assumptions, technology, and environment. So I want to talk about these separately, because fear is about failure, a fear of embarrassment, loss of control. Nobody wants to feel like they said something stupid in a meeting, right? We all want to feel like we're all prepared. So we're all in the meeting and we're thinking, I want to ask that, but I don't want to look dumb. So you lean next to Joe next to you, go, hey, Joe, why don't you ask? Because it's better for Joe to look dumb, right? You don't want to look dumb. And that's a huge problem in companies, because you get a lot of yes men, yes women, because nobody wants to shake up things or look like they are trying to, you know, confront their leaders. And leaders who haven't modeled the value of curiosity will come across that way. And, you know, I've had leaders look at me and say things that, you know, I had one guy, he asked me to do something and I said, sure, I'd be happy to do that. I've never had to. How do I do that? And he looked at me with disgust and said, I'm going to pretend I didn't hear that. So what does that make you feel? Well, first of all, it tells you you're an idiot, I guess. It tells you that you should know this. You should lie and pretend you know things. I don't know. You know, we get a lot of leaders who will say, don't come to me with problems unless you have solutions. And that sounded really good at the beginning, because it sounded like we were going to get rid of these whiners and complainers that didn't really have any ideas. But a lot of people don't know how to solve the problem. But if we say that, then we're saying we don't want to know about problems. So that's a huge, huge issue. And then the assumptions that we make, that's that voice in our head that tells us we're not going to be interested, I'm apathetic, it's unnecessary. Last time I did that, they gave me more work. Whatever it is, we all have that voice, you know, it talks us out of stuff. I sometimes I'll hold up a bottle of water in a talk that I'm giving, and I'll ask how much water is in this. Or actually I say, how heavy is this, I should say. And they'll say 6 ounces or 8 ounces or whatever. And I'll say, well, it doesn't matter. What matters is how long I hold it. Because if I hold it for a minute, it doesn't bother me. My arm's fine. You know, I hold it for an hour, I start to get tired. My arm gets tired. And after a day, my arm feels paralyzed. And that's kind of how our assumptions are. The voice in our head, if it's a fleeting thought, no big deal. We get past it. After an hour, we might hold on to it a little more. After a day, you know, it starts to stay with us. And so we have to recognize that we might be telling ourselves all of these things of things we could maybe be interested in, or maybe somebody would help us learn, but we talk ourselves out of them. So assumptions are a big thing. What I found interesting was technology was also a big factor, and curiosity is impacted by over and under utilization of technology. So it could either do it for you, or you're not trained in it, or you're overwhelmed by it. Some people have had great experiences in their childhood where they had a lot of foundational learning in technology. Steve Wozniak's one of his book, I loved his book, I Was, he talks about his dad telling him how to connect gadgets. He would come back with all these wires and get things from work and show him how the electronics should be connected and why this wire was necessary and how it brought electricity. But a lot of us don't have that experience. And a lot of us might be the greatest mathematicians in the world, but if somebody just threw us a calculator and or Siri did it for you, you're not ever going to really have the foundation behind it. So there's got to be times where we have high foundation days where we build without technology and we just learn behind it. And then there's got to be days where we take advantage of it and learn how can we use it and not become overwhelmed by it. And then environment's a big one for a lot of people, because it's everybody from your teachers and your family, your friends, your social media leaders, peers, your past leaders, your current leaders, everybody you've ever worked with, basically. And, you know, we know that curiosity can be influenced by everybody we're around. I mean, the numbers I gave earlier about how it peaks about age 5 of curiosity and then it tanks after that. A lot of that could be, you know, going into school, the teachers don't have time because they're teaching to the test, you got so many students in class, you can't answer why all the time. And, you know, our siblings can be brutal. I mean, if you do something that they don't think is cool, then you could take the wrath from that. And it's very challenging to look at what has impacted us. And I think that's one of the reasons why my research was so interesting to me, because I looked at these four factors of fear, assumptions, technology, and environment, fate, and those were the, you know, inhibitors for the curiosity code index, and they were pretty evenly matched. Assumptions were higher and environment were higher than technology maybe, but then you can have an overlap. Fear, you know, you could have fear of technology, for example, and so it was really fascinating to do the research. I studied thousands of people for years to see what inhibited them. And I started out by just putting a thread in LinkedIn and asking people. And then I thought, got really interested in that. And then I hired people to do, all this factor analysis. And I ended up doing my own research, because a lot of the research kept coming back in the same fashion of just trying to find out if you're curious or not. And I didn't want to do that. I wanted to find out what inhibits us. And it was kind of interesting to look at the difference between men and women. Men were less impacted by fear than women, but they were more impacted by that voice in their heads. They were kind of equal to women in technology, but then maybe more impacted by their environment. So, I mean, these are not, you know, these results are what I've seen, and I'd like to see more research done. But it is interesting to take a look at how these different factors impact us. And so what I do is I train people first of all, they take the Curiosity Code Index, and I either go do the training at companies myself, or I train consultants to give it, or I train HR professionals to give it. If those people get certified, they get 5 hours of SHRM recertification credit. So there's a lot of different versions of training that I offer. But what's really interesting is when they go through the training class, the employees are, when they're training about this, they get to find out their results from the CCI, and then they get to learn. It's just like taking a Myers-Briggs or a DISC or something. It takes 10 minutes. You get the big report back, the PDF, within a few minutes of taking it, and it's just real simple. And they get to get their results, and then they kind of go through this kind of personal SWOT analysis, which is kind of cool, because they look at ways to create SMART goals, measurable goals, those kinds of things, to overcome some of these areas that are inhibiting them. And so not only do they do that, but we do kind of the similar thing for the corporation as a whole, kind of back to like how they did at Disney. You go to the horse's mouth, you go to the employees and say, how can we fix these things within the company? But how can we help you become more curious? So if there's issues with, you know, innovation, engagement, whatever the company issues are, the training classes are a great starting place to go to the employees and say, how can we make you more curious so we can have this end product? How can we get cake, right? And you find out. And the trainers go back to leaders with this great report. This is what employees would like to do to help them improve so that we can all improve and make more money. So it's really important to, you know, the future of companies that, you know, the people have to try it, explore it, poke at it, question it. And it's just a huge thing that you need to ask yourself about, you know, how can I be vulnerable and allow this culture of learning? And maybe I don't have all the answers. And think about, what are you doing to foster curiosity? And what action plans do you have? How do you do this in this really tumultuous time? And thinking about this, it's very challenging for a lot of people. I have created a kind of a free course. A lot of people can get a lot of value out of if you're interested in taking it. If you go to drdianehamilton.com and scroll down to the bottom, it just offers a free course. If you sign up, it, you know, it's a simple thing. They just send it right to you, and you can learn a lot more about curiosity and the factors, and see a lot of videos from some of the talks I've given, and some of the stuff I'm talking about here is in there. But a lot of the chapters from the book are in there. And it's just a really good foundational way to learn more about curiosity. So I just wanted to give you that information, and I hope you check out drdianehamilton.com and curiositycode.com.